and asking the Lord to do and speak through me exactly what he wants our church to hear and experience, and what does he want us to know. And I believe, as always, I believe that this is a message from God for you today. I don't know who this is for or what, but just receive what God has for you today, all right? By the way, I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're here. Many of you, I haven't even got a chance to come up and say, hey, I'm glad you're here. I shook your hand or anything like that. But please, we're going to stay around here to the last person out, usually April and I. If you haven't got a chance to come up and say hi, would you please do that? We want to make sure that you know that you are loved and you're welcome here. And as April started off with, welcome home. Hey, welcome home. We're glad that you are here. So as I start this morning, I really felt led the Lord would lead me to this name of my message, really, is what does God want from me? What does God want from me? So we're going to look at that. There is a grace that God provides for all of us. Grace meaning gift. God gifts us with breath. God gifts us with life. God gifts us with talents and abilities. God gifts us with all things to enjoy, including our salvation, which has to be a gift because I could not afford it. The cost of my sin was too high and I could not pay the price. But because of Jesus' love for me, he died on a cross for my sin, and that grace alone is all I need for salvation. We love that grace so much. Teachers talk about how easy it is to simply believe in Jesus. It's as simple as that. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to earn anything. You simply gotta. It's easy. Just receive Jesus as your Savior. I'm becoming more and more aware of a little bit of pushback theologically on that notion. Not against grace, because grace is always true. Not against works for salvation. That will never be true. But is it easy? Is it easy? Is it easy to believe? Let me tell you something. Repenting is not easy. Repenting of my sins is not easy. And so there is a cost. I can't do anything to pay for my sins, but there is certainly a cost in following Jesus as a disciple. And so if that's true, if Jesus said, if you're going to build a building and you're foolish, you don't sit down and count the cost first to see if you have money enough to do it. If you're going to go take a city, he said you should count the cost to see if you have the manpower and ability to be able to overcome. There's something about this counting the cost. So what is the cost of following Jesus to me? What does God want from me? So number one, I got seven things here God wants from me. Number one, God wants to control all my money. I'm going to use me and my in there instead of you and yours, because you might take that wrong, but God wants to control all my money. Okay, so Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 24, it's going to be on the screen there for you. I'm going to read it out of here, out of my Bible, but he says, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break through and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." That's the key of this passage I want to share. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. What a resonating voice of Christ here. What powerful impact that one statement has to rattle my thinking. He says, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. God wants all my money. And of course, I'm still calling it my money, as Tony said that I probably shouldn't, right? Because it's all his, right? He all gave it to me, gave me the ability to earn money, the ability to be able to work and so forth. He has given me all things to enjoy, and yet I still want to call it my money. It's my money. How much of my money am I going to give God today? How much of my money am I going to share? How much of my money am I going to send to some poor starving kid on the other side of the world? How much of my money am I going to be able to put toward the expenses of the church? Oh, by the way, giving to foreign missions and seeing people saved is so much more rewarding thing to do with my money than to pay the electric bill and the insurances and things like that. So sometimes we fall into that trap. I want to be careful where I put my money. I want to make sure that my money has a good return on missions. And so if one person is leading hundreds to Christ and another is only leading two or three to Christ because of a different area and a different circumstance, I want to be careful that I spend my money carefully. See, it's all about my money. And yet I find out that God wants all my money. He wants all of it. Now, he lets me keep 90% of it, but he wants to make 10% the first off the top, wholly unto the Lord. It is his. The Bible says the tithe is the Lord's. And that is the first fruits of our giving. And so I give that to him first. But he wants all of it. I'm like, really, God? What am I going to live on? He's like, you can trust me. My God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. But he says, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. And the reason I want to camp out just a moment longer on this passage is if you are not giving and you get offended by this part of the message, I guarantee you're not already giving very well. That's not a smug or a mean thing. That's not supposed to be putting you down or anything. It's just the truth that the truth is if the Lord has your heart, then he has your wallet. Now, I'm not the one that came up with that. I heard it from somebody else, and I thought it was clever, but true. If the Lord has your heart, then he has your wallet. And I would dare say that he doesn't have your heart until he has your wallet. Now, in no way am I implying that you have to pay to be saved or pay to be at church or anything like that. None at all. All those things are free and blessed by God. But he's the one who wants to transform my life. And I believe in the transformational power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I believe that you can truly be changed in incredible, intangible ways that only God can do. And part of that is that he wants all your money. Now notice I didn't say the preacher wants all your money. I didn't say the bookkeeper wants all your money. I didn't say this church wants all your money. But I did say he wants all your money. Shocking. God, you want all my money? Yes, because where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Now, he had a few more things to say about money, and we're going to read the rest of it too. But unless we understand this thing of unless God has your money, he doesn't have your heart, we might want to look a little closer. Now, just for the most careful among us to be able to be clear, you do not have to come to church with any money. You don't have to come to Jesus with any money. You don't have to pay to get saved. It's free. And we're not about to take another offering up. We're not about to look and see what you gave. We're not about to shame anybody. I have to be faithful to what the Lord said about what he wants. And he wants all your money. He wants all of it. And then he'll tell you what he wants you to spend it on. Right. You can buy groceries with your money because he wants you to feed yourself and your family, keep you healthy. Right. He'll let you buy health insurance for it because if you don't pray first and ask God to heal you, well, you better buy some insurance. He's going to give you money for your house. He's going to say, hey, spend some of that my money on your house because you need somewhere to stay and shelter others. And he's going to say, hey, pay the car payment or they're going to come pick it up. And you got it. So he's going to allow you to be a good steward of all his money. But he wants all your money because where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Now, if all your treasure, give me my wallet, Abram. If all of your treasure, if all of your money is right here, where's my heart? Yeah. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. I guarantee you that the more you invest in the kingdom of God, the more your heart will be in what's going on. I guarantee you, you couldn't care less what's going on that mission board back there. You couldn't care less what's going on back there if you haven't donated any money to missions. But if you have given money, if you have invested time and effort and giving, then you are very excited and interested in what's going on. We heard about Grisha this morning. for those who have been able to donate and give to that project, whether it be $1 or 100 times that much, to be able to donate to that project of saving this life, to be able to make this adoption happen. I guarantee you, you're very interested and excited about the reports like you heard this morning. Why? Because where your treasure is, there your heart has followed. So I guess I'm going to move on because I got a lot more to cover than that. But there, so Jesus then continued to say, said, the lamp of the body is the eye. Therefore, your eye is good, the whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? Now, believe it or not, that does have something to do with money, but I'm not going to take the time to bring it all out. Verse 24, he goes right back to it again. He says, no one can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Mammon is the god of money. He names it as a god because he knows how likely we are to worship our butts instead of our Lord. Or wallets, I should say. It is tempting to always worship money more than God. It's tempting to worship the chasing after the dollar instead of God. But he says you cannot serve two masters. By the way, if he's the master, what does that make me? Servant. That's so nice. That's so pleasant. But you know what the Bible calls it? Slave. Yeah, so just be blunt. He's the master. I'm the slave. Now, I'm a willing slave, and I want to be his slave, all right? But it's still a master-slave relationship, which means who owns the money? Again, back to the master again, right? He says, you cannot serve God and the God of money. You have to choose. You cannot do both. So again, I say, if God doesn't have your money, then he doesn't have your heart. So that's what he said. Therefore, I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, what will you drink. How? He took all my money. No, he didn't take all your money. He lets you hold it. He lets you walk around with it, nice and close to your heart. He says, don't worry about your life, what you'll eat or drink, or about your body, what you'll put on. Is life not more than food and the body more than clothing? In other words, he says, is there more important things than stuff in your life? Is there something worth investing in the kingdom of God? Do you like seeing people come and get saved and get baptized? Do you like people like to see people come and grow in their faith? Do you like to see young people get saved? Do you like to see children come to Jesus in the children's ministry areas? Do you like to see that God is doing things? Are you investing in the church that does that for the master? Are you doing these things? He says, don't worry about your life. Don't worry about these priority things. He says, life is more than food, and the body is more than clothing. Look at the birds of the air, for they neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? Wait a minute, weren't we just slaves a second ago? Ah, we're also sons and daughters. We're only servants as long as we inhabit these bodies. But like the prodigal son coming home, one day we will no longer have to be servants and slaves of the master, but sons and daughters of God. Are you not more value than they? Verse 27, which of you by worrying can add one cubit to his stature? Can you add 1 inch to your height because of worrying about money? Really? We sure act like we do. We worry so much about money. We stress about money. So why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They don't toil or spin. And yet I say that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? You see, here's where we find that money and faith are connected to God's heart and our heart. So it's a faith issue. Therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? What shall we wear? For after all these things the Gentiles seek, For your heavenly Father knows what you that you have need of these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. But if you go after the things first with your money, then God doesn't have your heart. But if you give God your heart and you give him your money and you call him Lord and Master, he says, in that priority, then he will come back and supply all your need. And he will make sure that you not only have clothes, but you got duds that make Solomon looking great. And he says, even the lilies of the field are not, you know, he says, you not just garbage clothes, but nice stuff. And so he wants to take care of us, and he's going to take care of us well. But he wants to make sure it's an issue of faith. For after all these things the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knows that you have need of these things. But seek first the kingdom and his righteousness. All these things should be added to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow. For tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is the evil thereof, or the trouble of the day. And so I want to look at Luke chapter 18. Another thing he talks about here. Luke chapter 18, verses 18 through 30. These are a little bit extended passages, but the reason why I'm reading them is because Jesus did such a good job of preaching his sermon. I can't do a better job than him, so I'm just going to let him preach it. Does that sound good? All right. So Luke chapter 18 and verse 18 says, for a certain ruler ask him, saying, good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? So Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good but the one that is God. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not murder. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Honor your father and mother. He said, all these things I've done from my youth. When Jesus heard these things, he said to him, you still lack one thing. Sell all that you have and distribute to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come and follow me. Now, do you remember Jesus telling anybody else that? No, he just said, come, follow me. But to this guy, he said, oh, sell all you have and give it to the poor, and then come follow me. Why did he make that extra requirement for this young, rich young man? Because his heart was kneeled in worship to the God of money. And so he says, you've got to repent of your sin of worshiping money. And then, having been in a repentant state with evidence, fruit suitable to repentance, evidence of giving it away, then your heart will truly be repentant, and then you can come and follow me freely. And by the way, I think Jesus would have met all his needs just as well as he promised the rest. Yeah. So what verse am I on here? Verse 23. And so Jesus, when Jesus heard these things, he said, you lack one thing. When he heard this, he became very sorrowful, for he was very rich. And when Jesus saw that he became very sorrowful, he said, why? How hard it is for those who have riches to enter the kingdom of God. For it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Now those who heard it said, then who can be saved? But he said, the things which are impossible with men are possible for God. Then Peter said, see, we have left all to follow you. And he said to them, assuredly I say to you, there is not one who has left house or parents or brothers or children or for the sake of the kingdom of God who should not receive many times more in this present time and in the age to come eternal life. He says, there's not one of you who have given up things for the kingdom of God who will not find reward is coming. And so God wants to control all of your money because he wants to control your heart. And when he controls your heart, he will therefore be controlling all your money as well. But when you get into that situation, then he will make sure that you are arrayed like Solomon and that you have all your needs met, even if you don't work like birds. He will help you eat like a bird. And you know how birds eat? What, half their body weight every day, right? Okay, but at least I don't have to eat bugs, right? You can just eat seeds and stuff. All right, moving on. So what does God want from me? He wants all my money. Number two, God wants to control all my choices. John chapter 14 and verse 15, he says, if you love me, keep my commands. What? So not only does he want all my money, now he wants to control all my choices as well. If you love me, keep my commandments. Well, what commandments? Well, there are many things that Jesus told us that we should do, and things that he told us we shouldn't do, things we should avoid, and things we should, and we find those things written in his word, but we have choices, don't we? We can either choose to obey the master, or we can choose not to. Or, even better yet, we can pick and choose what we want to obey and the things we don't want to, right? But he said, if you love me, keep my commandments. If you love me, keep my commandments. Now, there probably is some ability to say, where's the workaround? What's the loophole? If I keep some of them, if I keep most of them, you know. But as soon as the heart goes and starts thinking like that, then you've missed the whole point of it. If a love relationship says, how many of the commandments can I keep? Not how few can I get away with. You see, if you love me, you're going to keep. So he wants to control all your choices. And here's another one in Deuteronomy chapter 30 and verse 19. And in that passage it says, I call heaven and earth as witness today against you that I have set before you life and death, he said, to the children of Israel, to God's people in that day, as they stood ready to go into the promised land that he gave them and would be able to conquer the giants and gain the land and gain the victory, but there would be opposition, but along the way it would be a journey of faith. And as he sets them up for that, he says, I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, that both you and your descendants may live. Sounds like an easy choice, doesn't it? I mean, does it? I mean, it's kind of a no-duh, right? So we're all choosing life all the time, right? We're always choosing blessing and not curse. We're always obeying all his commandments, right? We never get selfish. We never do what we want. We never get lazy. None of those things ever happen because it's so black and white. It's so easy. We're you know, blessing and cursing. Choose life. But we find, of course, with our own human nature that we make choices that are not good. But he wants to control all my choices. He wants to pretend like he's God and has the ability to work out the circumstances based on what I do. Yeah. So here's this very controlling person, entity, that thinks he's God or something and wants to control all my money and all my choices. And the next one on the list here is God wants to control my thoughts. Like, wow, okay, it's one thing for my money. Okay, it's one thing to say I got to make better choices, but now you want to actually go in and control my mind? I mean, when people try to control our thoughts and our minds, we call them bad names, but it's okay if God just comes in and wants to control your thoughts? Oh yeah, he's still God, isn't he? This is the deal of following him. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 5. It says, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Every thought into captivity. He wants to control my thoughts. He wants to bring every one of my thoughts captivity into what he wants my thoughts to be. Wow. To the obedience of Christ. So here's another passage, Colossians chapter 3 and verse 2. He says, set your minds on things above, not on things of the earth. Don't tell me what to do. Well, what he tells us is good. What he tells us is for us. It's not against us. But how we resist the notion that God should be able to control so much in my life, even my thought life. You're going to tell me what to think now, God? Yeah. Set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. Well, what if I don't want to? Well, yeah, how's that working for you? When we set our minds on things of the earth, we get disappointed because moth and rust, you know, corrupt, and thieves break through and steal, just to quote the master on that a little bit. When we find out that there's such a thing as a law of diminishing results, that whenever something that brought us pleasure the first time, the second time we do it, it's not quite as good. And the third time, it's even less. And the fourth time, it's just like, it's pretty good. And fifth and sixth time, you find out that there's a law of diminishing results, that when we do things our way, when we give in and indulge sin, we find that even sin is disappointing. After a while, there's not even any fun in that. And God's like, I can save you a lot of trouble. In fact, I insist, set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. Don't tell me what to do. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 8. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there's anything virtuous, anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. I don't want to. Okay. Yeah, how's that going to work out for you? Now, I'm not picking on you. We all do this, don't we? Whatsoever things are pure, lovely, of good report, virtuous, praiseworthy. Think on these things. No, I'm sure there's something juicier on these videos somewhere. It's got to be something. Somebody's probably going to crash and die somewhere. Somebody's going to be meditating in the jungle, and a tiger is going to eat them. Amen. Yeah. Amen. There's got to be something cool and interesting to watch on here. Whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are good report. If you're wondering why I'm getting such a reaction in the room, somebody that will go unnamed that I spent a little time with yesterday told that story, and she thought that was so funny. And nobody else did, but we laughed at that she thought it was so funny. But anyway, set your mind on these things. So God wants to control my thoughts. He wants to control your money. He wants to control all your choices. He wants to control your thoughts. And now he wants to control who, he wants to tell me who I can love. Whoa, now you're meddling with modern society. God wants to tell you who you can love. Well, let's look at a few of those commandments here. 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 and 8 says, Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. So he starts out with, Brethren, let us love one another. So who is God telling me to love now? Okay, I guess I have to love you. Mark chapter 12, verses 30 and 31. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart. Oh, man. Don't even get me started on that one. But let's say we're really successful at that. Let's say we love God and prove it and live it, and that's all perfect, you know. He says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. Yeah, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. Now he's going to tell me who to love again. Now I can say I'm loving God, but, you know, nobody really knows. But you can tell if I love you. You can tell by how we treat each other, whether or not I love you. So there he goes meddling, telling me who to love. Let's look at another one, Matthew chapter 5, verses 44. But I say to you, love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use and persecute you. Wow. So he wants me to love one another, wants me to love my neighbor. I kind of like my neighbor. He's a pretty good guy, you know. And in fact, the one living beyond that, that's Jerry and Kim, and they're pretty lovable, you know. So, you know, I get the neighbor things all right. But love your enemy. Ah, that's a little harder. But he tells us that we should do this. All right, so let's look at another one. 1 John chapter 4, verses 20 and 21. He says, if someone says, I love God and hates his brother, liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? Now, I got an answer for that because I'm human, right? I can be like, well, duh, because God doesn't bother me. He's not in my face, but you're in my face and you bother me. So that's how I can love God and not love. I mean, I got an answer for that, right? But he didn't ask me that. He just said, preach what I said. He said, if you can't love your brother that you can see, then how do you say that you love God who you can't see? Troubling. Love one another, love my neighbor, love my enemy, love my brother. By the way, sometimes it's easier to love my enemies than it is to love my brother, because I expect harm from my enemy, but I don't expect harm from my brother and sister in Christ. And yet it still comes, doesn't it? Yeah, we still hurt each other. We still say stupid things. We say our arrogant things. We say selfish things. We do and do not do things to each other, and we offend one another pretty easily and constantly. It's amazing you're all still here. But he says that we should love one another. John, 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Now he's going to tell me what I can't love. Do not love the world or the things that are in the world. If any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Okay, so let me get this Love one another. Love your neighbor. Not your neighbor's wife. Got it. Love your enemy. Love your brother. But don't love the world, neither the things that are in the world. Because if any man loved the world, the love of the Father is not in him. How much control does he want? He wants so much control. He wants to tell me how he spent all my money. He wants to tell me how to make my choices. He wants to control my thoughts. He wants me to tell me who I can love. And then number five, he wants me to give up my life. Matthew chapter 16, verses 24 and 25, he says it like this. Then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Now, I don't know about you, but that's a no-win scenario for me. I mean, I'm looking at a no-win scenario. How is my selfish self going to win this one? Because it says whoever desires to save his selfish self will lose it. But if you decide, okay, I'll play your little game, God, then I'm just going to love, you know, that whoever loses his life for my, I have to lose my life for your sake? So I either have to lose my life or I have to lose my life. Which is it, God? That's a no-win scenario for my flesh nature. See? But not my spirit man. Because when my flesh nature loses, my spirit man wins. Which is the plan. So he wants me to give up even my life. And he tells me, if you hang on to your life, your way, your attitude, your cool, your whatever, whatever defines who you are, then nobody's going to tell me what to do, because I'm individual, I'm a me. Then if you hang on to that, you'll lose it. He says, but if you lose your own selfish nature for his sake, you will find amazing life. That you look back at your old rag of a self, your last life, and you go, what did I see in that? I believe in better than that. Number six, God wants me to give up my identity. Wow, give up my life, give up my identity. Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20 says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Wow, go back to that where it says, yet not I. He says, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God. Yet it is no longer I who live. It's no longer me. Christ took over. Or he's taking over. He wants me to lose my identity because somehow the Father thinks Jesus living in me looks better than me living in me. What's he thinking? I'm a pretty cool guy. I kind of like me. I look in the mirror and go, looking good. Now, if you don't do that because of your visual appearance, you will do it because of your cool self. One way or another, we're all that way. We don't want to lose our identity in Christ. I kind of like who I am. But when Christ begins to transform your life and you become looking more and more like him, you start talking like him, you start acting like him, you start doing like him, you are in danger of remembering who you are. Yeah, go for it. Go for broke. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet, but I, not I, but Christ lives in me. In the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Wow, so losing my identity to gain Christ. That's what he wants. A little more blunt with the giving up the identity part is found in Colossians chapter 3 and verse 3. Coming up. That's all right. Why I always keep the hard copy. It says, for you died. Can we just let that hang in the air for a minute? For you died. Who is he talking to? Paul's talking to the church at Colossae. He might as well be talking to this church. And it's addressed to everybody in the church. And he says, for you died. I mean, is there really any point in saying anything beyond that? I mean, if you're dead, that's it. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. So he wants me to lose my identity. He wants me to die to self. Paul said it about himself. He says, I die daily. And I keep resurrecting my old ugly corpse. And it keeps dragging me around, but I keep having to kill the old man. And I kill my old man, and I kill my old man until they think, hey, watch what you're saying there. Somebody's going to come arrest you. We have to kill our old man. We have to die daily. He says, you have died. We need to act like it now. Your life that you think is your life is now hidden in Christ, with Christ and God. He wants you to even lose your identity. And he wants me to be okay with all this. Number one, he wants to control all my money. He wants to control all my choices. He wants to control my thoughts. Thought control. He wants me to tell me who I can love. He wants me to give up my life. And even my memory, even my identity as my individuality also has to be sacrificed. And then number seven, God wants me to be happy about it. Let's look at Matthew chapter 13, verses 45 and 46. It's a two-sentence story, a two-verse story. Jesus said, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls, who when he had found one pearl of great price, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. The pearl of great price. April, you guys prepared? Come on up, musicians, if you would, because we're going to use the last couple of minutes here to be able to think about what we've heard today. God wants us to be happy with our decision to give up everything. He said it's like this, when you found the pearl of great price, which is the gospel, Jesus, and the life in Jesus, the eternal life I found in him, the whole God life thing he wants for me, that he said you should value that God life in you, both for salvation and for what he can do in your life so much that you would be willing to sell everything, to give up the God of your heart, to give up your time, your talents, your treasures, to love who he says to love, to do what he says to do, to let him control your thought life, your identity, your choices, is that you would be willing to give up all of that for him. Do we do that? Are we willing to pay that kind of price? If God's spoken to your heart, then why don't we all stand and make it easier for movement? But if you'd like to come up and pray at these altars, nobody's going to mess with you. Nobody's going to try to figure out what you're praying about. But if you want to make some kind of commitment to God based on what you've heard today, would you come? Just come and kneel and pray and say, Lord, one of those points, I need to talk about you a little bit with you. I need to see if I'm ready to count the cost on this. I want to do that. If that's you, then please come and use these altars. But while you're coming, I also want to talk to others who might be considering whether or not they want to be a Christian to begin with. Salvation is free. Going to heaven is free to you. And I'm offering it to you today on his behalf, that Jesus has given me the permission to share with you that you can be saved today. You can go to heaven today for free. It won't cost you anything except your repentance from your old ways and saying, Lord, I'm all in. You can have everything else in my life. And if you're willing to repent of your sin and say, God, I'm ready to receive you, then if you'd like to bow your head and pray this prayer with me right now, then you can be saved. You can begin this journey. If you just pray this prayer, dear God, I'm sorry for my sins. I'm sorry for the wrong things I've done. And now I repent of my sin, and I turn toward you, and I receive your free gift of eternal life that cost you everything on the cross. Thank you, Jesus, for saving my soul. Thank you for paying for my sins. And I acknowledge that it cost me nothing, but it cost you everything. In Jesus' name. Now, if you just gave your heart to Jesus, or if you've been saved a long time, the rest is on the bargaining table now, isn't it? So, April, if you would, lead us through a verse or two, and let us just take a moment to consider our decision with God.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus.
Yes, there is.
There is power in the name of Jesus. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus.
He can break your chains. That's right. Amen. 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 Thank you, Lord. I got it.
Sufficient sacrifice, so freely given, such a price, bought our redemption, heaven's gates swing wide.
Amen. Amen. God has done something in your heart today, if God has challenged you today, if God has in any way got your attention today, and you have made any kind of decision for Him to say yes to Him in any area of your life that we talked about today, then the Word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, is able to divide between soul and spirit and thought and intent of the heart, and it will accomplish that which He has sent it for. The Word of God has gone forth today, and if you have responded to Him in any way, whether it be at these altars or in your seat, then it has been worth the price of admission today to come. No pun intended about your money. I hope that you want to go to a church where you are challenged. I promise not to leave you not challenged. Come back next week, I'm going to challenge you even more, but I'm right there with you. Because these are things that we all struggle with, but these are all things that we can have victory in. And when we do these things His way, we become better for it, more like Him, happier people with His identity than I could ever be with my own. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May He make His face to shine upon you. May He lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace. For you're blessed in the city, you're blessed in the field, you're blessed when you come and when you go. And if the Lord is on your side, who shall you fear? For who is like the Lord?
Nobody.
Go in His peace today. God bless you.